Madam Ambassador, Madam Chargé, Mr. Deputy Director General, ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to open up this year's Joint Industry Outreach Seminar on Strategic Trade Management. I just want to take a couple of seconds to, everybody should have a program on their table. If not, let us know and we'll get you some. This kind of walks us through what our agenda looks like today. And so we're just going to go ahead and get started. Let me first introduce Stephanie Siptak-Romnoth, the Chargé d'Affaires of the U.S. Embassy. She oversees 19 government agencies in advancement of the embassy's wide-ranging efforts on bilateral security, economic, and people-to-people cooperation. Her most recent assignment was as Minister Counselor for Public Diplomacy at the U.S. Embassy in Mexico City, where she managed public diplomacy staff across 9 consulates and implementing U.S. government public outreach efforts that covered work of 29 U.S. agencies in Mexico. Stephanie previously served as the Deputy Chief of Mission in Bamako, Mali, where she had a team of 300 interagency colleagues in shaping and implementing the U.S. government response to political, security, and humanitarian crises in the country. A specialist in the field of public diplomacy, Stephanie's other assignments include Senior Deputy Director in the Office of Public Diplomacy at the Bureau of European Eurasian Affairs, Career Development Officer for the Mid-Level Public Diplomacy Officers, Public Affairs Officer in Mali, Assistant Public Affairs Officer in Tunisia, Staff Assistant and Political Officer at the U.S. Mission to the United Nations, and Vice Counsel in Monterrey, Mexico. Prior to joining the Foreign Service, Stephanie was an officer in the U.S. Navy. A graduate of Georgetown University School of Foreign Service, Stephanie is married and has 2 daughters. She speaks French and Spanish. Ma'am.
Good morning. On behalf of the U.S. government, including our embassy in Singapore and our many colleagues from Washington, D.C., it is my great pleasure to welcome all of you here this morning for our joint industry outreach on strategic trade management. A very special thank you to Singapore Customs and Japan's Ministry of Economy, Trade, and Industry for co-sponsoring this year's event. This is my 3rd year in Singapore, and the 3rd time I have had the honor of joining my good friend, Tek Leong, in kicking off this important annual event. Tek Leong, I think we must be doing a pretty good job as the audience continues to grow exponentially every year. Please allow me to also welcome the representatives of the governments of the Philippines, the Netherlands, Germany, and Malaysia, as well as our industry participants. And a very special welcome also to my dear friend and neighbor, the Ambassador of the Netherlands, Her Excellency Margaret Vono. So, 3 years, so I thought maybe I'd take it a little different direction this year. So I thought I would begin my brief remarks with a book recommendation. So, Factfulness, 10 Reasons We Are Wrong About the World and Why Things Are Better Than You Think. So it's written by a Swedish public health expert, Dr. Hans Rosling, and I recommend it because, among other things, Bill Gates has provided a free copy to every U.S. university graduate in the United States, so it's not just me who says that this is a good book. But I won't spoil it for you, but I will say that, as the title suggests, Dr. Rosling provides hard data that, contrary to popular wisdom, most countries in the world have in recent decades made enormous progress in health, life expectancy, girls' education, and poverty reduction. So as I was preparing my remarks for this morning, I was thinking about what it takes to achieve progress in areas that appear overwhelming and impossible to change. So Dr. Rosling tells us that it's about knowing the facts, studying the data, and most importantly, interpreting the data correctly. The anecdotes in this book, combined with the insight that I've gleaned as a diplomat serving around the world, also point to partnership as the best and often only way to confront challenges that we cannot otherwise overcome alone. And that's why it's so important that we are gathered here today to strengthen our shared understanding of the importance of export controls in minimizing the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction, both here in Southeast Asia and throughout the world. Both of our sectors, the business community and government, have critical responsibilities in this effort, and neither of us can succeed alone. Both of us, all of us, need access to data and clarity on the differing regulations, because it is only then that companies, big or small, can develop their own compliance programs that will keep the region and the world that much safer. So we are deeply grateful for your presence here and for that of our numerous facilitators. As you can see from your agenda, you will hear from presenters from 7 different countries, each with their own export control law or Strategic Trade Act. Particularly important from the perspective of regional trade is the fact that all of the ASEAN nations with strategic trade controls are represented here in the room: Singapore, Malaysia, and the Philippines. This is an unprecedented opportunity for you to speak directly to key government regulators and experts in the field. On behalf of my government and my embassy, know that we stand ready throughout the year to continue this important discussion. For companies purchasing U.S. origin items, we have government agencies willing to assist you to ensure compliance with U.S. law. When dealing with defense articles or military goods, you can receive advice from the State Department's Directorate of Defense Trade Controls. And our Department of Energy can answer questions about U.S. origin nuclear energy-related materials, while the Commerce's Bureau of Industry and Security is available to discuss dual-use items that have both military and civil end use. Many of these agencies are represented at my embassy here in Singapore and are available to meet with you at any time to address your questions and your concerns. And with that said, this is a fitting moment for me to acknowledge the hard work and dedication of Scott Anderson, without whom we would not be gathered here. He is also an important point of contact for you today and throughout the year as you apply what you learn over the next few hours. So allow me to end with a quote from Dr. Rosling, who said, and I quote, "I am not an optimist. I'm a very serious possibilist. It's a new category where we take emotion apart and we just work analytically with the world," end quote. So I hope we can all embrace the idea of being possibilists. Yes, it is possible to be smarter and more innovative than the world's proliferators. Yes, it is possible to work together to minimize the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction. And yes, it is possible that one day in Singapore, like today, can make a difference in the safety and security of our region and the world. So I wish all of you a very productive seminar. May you depart with the data and the partnerships to make your company, your government, and our world more successful. Thank you.
Giving our next opening remarks is Katsuro Igari, the Director for Security Export Control Administration, Ministry of Economy, Trade, and Industry of Japan, and proud sponsors of this year's event also. Thank you, sir.
Good morning, everyone. It is a great pleasure for me to deliver the opening remarks on behalf of the Japanese government. I would like to express my sincere gratitude to the Singapore Customs and the United States that the Department of State Exhibits team and for organizing that this event. And particularly, I very much appreciate your hard work for organizing today's event. The global security situation is always changing, and therefore we should take into account carefully the current threat we are facing. Now the world is watching the situation in North Korea and not to restart the nuclear test and ballistic missile launches. In this regard, we need to continue the implementation of a UN Security Council Resolution 2397, which enhanced the sanctions measures towards North Korea. In addition to the implementation of respective resolution towards North Korea, Japan is also implementing that further stringent sanctions to North Korea, including the total bans of export and imports. So, and the world is also that they have to continue that the efforts to prevent the proliferation of the weapons of mass destruction. According to the recent media report, chemical weapon was that they used in Syria again. The fight against the terrorism, international terrorism, is also still that critical. In order to prevent the use of weapons of mass destruction by countries of concern or terrorists, all countries and regions must enforce the export control systems strictly in accordance with the United Nations Security Council Resolution 1540. Japan revised the Foreign Exchange and Foreign Trade Act last year in order to further strengthen export control systems. Japan is also addressing the enhancement of security export control to academia. Recently, technology controls in university is regarded as it is also crucial for the effective implementation of export control. However, it is difficult to say that the universities have sufficient export control systems for the transfer of critical technology. For this reason, we are supporting that efforts by universities and the researchers or academia to comply with the related laws and regulations. There's also, this is also very a big and new challenge for us, all of us, since that the activities of the countries of concern for that the procurement for their procurement also very much diversified. It is getting more difficult to address the proliferators that the attempts, so that the international community should also work together. Japan very much highly appreciates that the continuous efforts by Singapore government. Since that this, Singapore was the first country which introduced the strategic goods control systems among ASEAN region, and now that Singapore is the most experienced country on export control in this region. The effective export control system cannot be achieved by the efforts of a small group of countries. It is also very important to strengthen that the mutual cooperation and the information exchange to achieve this agenda. Today that we have representatives from the government of Malaysia and the Philippines, it is also very much encouraging. I believe this seminar now becomes one of the most important event for that effective implementation of strategic trade control in this ASEAN region. I sincerely hope that you will find this seminar interesting and very useful. So I wish you a fruitful the seminar today. Thank you very much.
Now it is my pleasure to introduce Lim Tech Leong, the Deputy Director General, or he is currently the Deputy Director General, Corporate Facilitation. As the Deputy Director General, he oversees the Corporate Division as well as the Trade Division in Singapore Customs. He is also covering the role of Assistant Director General Trade. As covering Assistant Director General Trade, he directly oversees all customs matters relating to trade regulation, facilitation, and supply chain security. So it makes trade easy, fair, and secure. Deputy Director Lim Tech Leong, thank you.
Morning, everyone. Her Excellency Margaret Vono, Ambassador of the Netherlands to Singapore and Brunei. Ms. Stephanie Saptaratna, Church of Affairs, Embassy of the United States. Mr. Kasuro Igari, Director for Security Export Control of Administration, Ministry of Economy, Trade and Industry of Japan. Distinguished speakers, guests, participants, good to see you again. As my friend Stephanie said, she is not her first time here, so for me as well, many of you see me around. I think this is probably my 9th or 10th time doing this. Sometimes it almost sounds like a broken record when we do this. That's why we always arrange for the other, my esteemed colleagues, to do the opening first, so that much has been said by them, and I can do a shorter one. But anyway, good to see everyone again. This time around is a bit later part of the year that we organize this. It's December. Despite being December, where most people are not around, away for vacation, I still see many of you are here, and the sign up for this event has always been overwhelming, just like for this time. Okay. Today's seminar is jointly organized by U.S. Bureau of Industry and Security, BIS in short, U.S. Export Control and Related Border Security, EXPS, U.S. Department of Energy, Japan Ministry of Economy, Trade Industry, MITI, and Singapore Customs. Have about 400 participants here, and as I said, it's always oversubscribed. I think last year or so, we promised that we'd do something new, so that's why we have a different arrangement this year around, instead of the usual sitting round tables. Hopefully to encourage interaction among you guys, for you to share around best practices, or maybe ask questions each other, or to sort of nudge each other to ask questions. We have later sessions during the day. But at the same time, we're trying something new this year as well. We're doing a video recording, as promised, I think, last time, so that your colleagues who could not be here or your friends could not be here for other companies could view the recording on internet. And of course, if you have questions on whatever's been spoken, shared, feel free to ask questions to the speakers. I'm sure they leave their email contacts behind later, so that we can continue to learn from each other even after today's event. Of course, it's not constrained to today. I think, as you all know, threat of export control to national domestic global security is still real. It's a constant. Despite the successful summit last year here in Singapore, the threat is still there. The ban on DPRK goods is still there. It's not been relaxed in Singapore. UN sanctions are still there. So do continue to keep a watchful eye and be compliant with the various regulations. We know that the perpetrators of WND and export control infringement continue to abuse, to make use of the flow of legitimate trade to hide their illicit transactions. As the global economy grows, as the importance of global trade grows, as we, among all the countries, try to facilitate trade, e-commerce, and other forms of trade, I think we need to continue to be mindful of such perpetrators, to prevent them from abusing the proper trade system to hide their illicit transactions. I think for that, I think, as we always said, there are a few things that we need to take note of, and that's why also we are here. There are certain elements in the supply chain or in the strategic goods control that we play importance. The first one, of course, is at the regulator's end. At the regulators, we constantly sharpen our saw, be mindful of what's going on in the industry, what the new threats are, continue to work with like-minded partners, with international partners, like our friends from the US, from Japan, and other parts of the world, to prevent illicit diversion of WND and export control goods. Trade is international, therefore there's a need to collaborate together. At the same time, we work together in industries in terms of reaching out to you guys to raise awareness on what's going on with both the domestic controls as well as what's happening in the world. That's why we have invited speakers from different regions, different countries here to share with you about the updates in terms of the export control regime, because that affects you as well. We need the industry to be mindful of what they could do, to partner with us to make sure that supply chain is not compromised. That's why we have companies here to share about good practices in ICP, Internal Compliance Program. At the same time, we also get ourselves updated in terms of what's out there in technology, in updating our list of control. I think you're well aware of our changes to Singapore export control list this year. If you're not aware of, please go and take a look today. It's available on the internet. I think it takes many hands to clap. I would say I borrow a phrase from what we do in the social service, called many hands approach. The regulator can do so much. Singapore has 9 million or 10 million transactions a year, and there's transshipment trade, and each country has faced a lot of trade. It's not possible for each regulator to see and scrutinize each transaction. While we put our risk parameters in, we use technology to regulate trade to ensure that no diversion happens. I think we need the industry to play a part, to be the watchful eyes and ears on the ground, to tell us what's going on, to be compliant so that we can spend our limited effort in going after the bad guys, per se, So I think that's why we are here, and we definitely applaud the efforts industry as well, and the various regulators of the world to do what we can. I think we are privileged today here to have speakers from Japan, Malaysia, Philippines, Netherlands, the Netherlands, and the United States to give us updates, of course, for you to also question them. It's rare to have that many speakers here on stage. So do big use of opportunity here to ask what you need to ask for updates, to ask how you can improve a process better or any queries you have. Last but not least, I think I'd like to thank our fellow co-organizers, the US Bureau of Industry and Security, the US Export Control and Related Border Security Program, and Japan Ministry of Economy and Trade Industry for the generous support and assistance for today's event. Lunch is on them, of course. Wish all of you then and I think a fruitful seminar. Definitely hope to see you again. Probably I'll be here again next year, I don't know. We shall see then. Thank you very much.
There we go. Okay, so Janice, if you want to go ahead and, we're going to go ahead and start our presentations. Ms. Janice Damayakyak, she is an attorney with the Strategic Trade Management Office of the Department of Trade and Industry of the Philippines. Now, as we're getting ready and getting her situated up here, I want to take care of a couple of housekeeping issues. Number one, I know we're working today. I know you still have jobs when you're not here. And I know you have cell phones. So please silence your cell phones. Let's make sure that the beeping, dinging, and ringing isn't interfering with our panels. Number two, the restrooms are not outside of the doors. They're actually inside to the left under the exit sign in the back. So that way you're not having to go in and out. Lunch, the all-important lunch. There's two places to eat. Number one is right out the door here. Number two is downstairs. I'm going to ask that people generally move to the downstairs part because it's much bigger, much more friendly. Up here, we're going to be kind of cramped. But as we're doing that, two things. At break and at lunch, Singapore Customs has graciously has people set up to talk to you about their program trade first. We'll be discussing that throughout the day. Take the opportunity to talk with these folks there, too. Also, you'll notice, like the Deputy Director General said, we changed the seating arrangements this year. I want to get people to talk to each other. It's that important within this kind of world and this kind of industry of compliance to start socializing with each other. Because as you socialize with each other, you're not the first one to see this problem. You're not the first one to get that call Friday afternoon at 5:30 wanting something and not know how to respond or react to that. Your colleagues, your competitors, your supply chain, your distributors, your buyers, they've probably run across it. Use this opportunity to talk. As you've heard our opening remarks also, you have an opportunity to discuss and ask questions of seven different regulatory organizations in trade compliance. Take the opportunity. I know sometimes we don't want to stand up in front of a room of almost 400 people. I get that. Come grab me, ask me the question, I'll pass it to them. Grab somebody from Customs or somebody from BIS or somebody from METI. Ask them. They'll get it to one of our panelists. Take the opportunity to ask these questions. Last but not least, for the first two presentations by the Philippines and by Malaysia, let's hold questions until the panel after break because they will be sitting on that panel also. So without further ado, Ms. Janice, thank you so much.
Thank you, Scott. Mabuhay, good morning, everyone. I'm Janice Nimayakyak from the Philippines Strategic Trade Management Office. And this morning, I'm going to give a presentation on our Strategic Trade Management Act. But before I begin, I would like to take this opportunity to thank our partners from the Singapore, U.S., and Japanese government for giving me the opportunity to present before you today our STMA. So here is an outline of my presentation. I'm going to give an overview of our STMA, our organizational structure, our registration and authorization procedures, our plans for implementation and the administrative and criminal penalties under the law. So there are three important things that you need to remember about the STMA. First, our National Strategic Goods List, which lists down the items that we're going to regulate. Second, the scope of the STMA, or who are covered under the law. And third, what activities are covered under the law. Let me begin with our National Strategic Goods List. So our National Strategic Goods List has three annexes. Annex 1 is our dual-use goods list. Annex 1 is our military goods list. Annex 2 is our dual-use goods list. And Annex 3 is our nationally controlled goods list. Annex 1, military goods as defined under the STMA, are items, software, and technology that are specifically designed, developed, configured, adopted, or modified for military end use. So the list that we're going to use is the EU military list. For the Annex 2, dual-use goods list, this covers items, software, and technology that can be used for both civil and military end use. Annex 3, nationally controlled goods list. So these are goods which are placed under unilateral controls for reasons of national security, foreign policy, anti-terrorism, crime control, and public safety. As of now, there are no items in the list, but it is placed there by our government because in the future, if we find that there are items which are not in Annex 1 or Annex 2, we may add it to our NSGL or the National Strategic Goods List. So there are instances where an item which is not listed under the NSGL may still require an authorization or license with our office. And this is covered by our catch-all provision under Section 11 of the STMA. As you can see here, there are four boxes. In the first three boxes here, 1, 2, and 3, this would require the STMO to inform the exporters or authorization holders that the goods or services may be used partly or entirely for WMD. Second, when the country of destination is subject to an international sanction or an arms embargo. And third, when the goods may be used as parts or components of military items listed in the NSGL that have been exported without a license. But the most important part of our catch-all provision is this box, box number 4. So when the exporter knows or suspects that the unlisted goods may be used for this too, then there is a need to apply for an authorization or license with the STMO. Okay. So initially, we're going to regulate items under Annex 2, and we have identified that certain items with the codes that you can see below are currently being regulated by our Philippine National Police Firearms and Explosives Office. So we don't want to duplicate the licensing that's being done by our industry stakeholders. So for the items that you see here with these codes, there's no need to apply with the Strategic Trade Management Office, but we encourage our industry stakeholders to apply with our PNP FEO. Scope of the STMA. Who are covered under the STMA? So the STMA both has territorial jurisdiction and extraterritorial jurisdiction. So within the territory of the Philippines, it applies to natural as well as juridical persons who engages or intends to engage in strategic trade. So natural persons are persons like you and I, and under Philippine law, juridical persons cover corporations, partnerships, associations, etc. What's also important here is that the law has extraterritorial jurisdiction. So it covers all Filipino persons wherever located when they want to provide the activities covered under the STMA. coverage of the STMA, what activities are covered under the STMA? There are several activities covered by the STMA. We have export, transit, transshipment, import, re-export, reassignment, and we have what we call the provision of related services. Under related services, it covers four activities: brokering, financing, transporting, and technical assistance. But what I want to share with you today is our definition of export. So under Philippine law, export is defined as an actual shipment of strategic goods out of the Philippines. However, export also covers making available in electronic form the software and technology to persons outside the Philippines. So if there's a transmission of software and technology either in electronic form or in non-electronic form, when we say non-electronic form, when the software is transmitted through face-to-face communication, personal demonstration, or just merely handling over material or information to a foreign person, then that is covered under the STMA. As you may see, there are several activities under our law. So there is a proposed phase implementation of the different activities under our law, and the message that my principals wanted to tell everybody is that the schedule is not cast into stone, but will be adjusted as we may deem fit. But for registration, it will be regulated by the first quarter of 2019, export third quarter of 2019, transit and transshipment first quarter of 2020, re-export and reassignment third quarter of 2020, related services first quarter of 2021, and import on the third quarter of 2021. Our organizational structure. So we have a high council or a body, a central policy-making body, which we call the National Security Council Strategic Trade Management Committee, or the NSC-STMCOM. It is composed of the majority of our cabinet members, but is headed by our executive secretary from the Office of the President, and the vice chairman is from the secretary of my department, the Department of Trade and Industry. Our office is the implementing arm for all the policies that this body will come up with. But basically, our function is to issue or deny authorizations or licenses, as well as registrations that are being filed with us. So this is the structure of our office. It will be headed by a director, and there will be three divisions. We have the Policy and Enterprise Relations Division. Basically, this division will handle industry outreach, the webinars, all the documents that will be posted in our website. Second, we have the Registration and Authorization Division. They will handle the applications for registration and authorization or license filed with the STMO. And lastly, we have the Compliance and Investigation Division. It has the Compliance Unit and Investigation Unit for compliance checks, most especially for global licenses that will be issued by our office. Next, I want to share with you our registration and authorization procedures. So this is an overview of our licensing procedure. There are two mandatory steps that you need to do if you want to apply for a license with the STMO. First, there's a need to register before you may apply for an authorization or license. Because if a company is not registered with our office, then that company cannot apply for a license. So these are the two important steps. Let me first discuss registration. I'm sharing with you a sample registration form, which we sent out to most of our industry stakeholders in the Philippines last week. So the most important content is on this part. Information on commodity description, NSGL code, countries of destination, etc. There are two important reasons why we require to know what items a company produces and to which countries they are bound for. First, we want to map out what items are actually being produced by our exporters in the Philippines. And from the data that we'll gather from your registration application, then we will come up with our first general license. And second, we want to know which companies are eligible to apply for a global license with the STMO. So these are just additional supporting documents that industry stakeholders are required to append to their application for registration. So you may take a photo or check them later. So second, authorization. Or authorization is just license under Philippine law. So there are three types of authorization under the STMA. We have an individual license, a global license, and a general license. An individual license is a license that is granted to an exporter with respect to just one end user. It may cover several items in our NSGL. It is valid for 2 years. A global license, on the other hand, is a license or authorization that is granted to an exporter with respect to several end users or consignees, and it is valid for 5 years. And we have another license, which we call a general license. This is an authorization to engage in strategic trade to destination countries under the conditions specified under the general authorization. What this means is that you don't need to apply for a license for this type of license, the general license, but it will be merely published. So once our industry stakeholders are registered and this general license is posted in our website, that company may just download it and then they can use it right away. So this authorization is valid for a lifetime until revoked by the STMO. So I've mentioned earlier, there's another type of license which covers several end users. It's what we call a global license, or what they call here in Singapore as bulk license. So these are the proposed ICP elements, and the guidelines for this will be issued by our office this month. So the first, there are 10 proposed elements. One is management commitment, 2, ICP structure and responsibility, 3, screening procedures, 4, shipment control, 5, ICP training, 6, internal audit, 7, ICP standard operating procedure, 8, record keeping, 9, reporting and corrective action, and 10, technology control plan, if applicable. So this is our authorization procedure. This is what happens once your application for authorization or license is filed within our office. First, initial checks are done. So it's what we check is that if all the additional supporting documents are complete or all the fields in your application form are filled up. Second, it goes through technical review. What we check here is the end use of the commodity. And third is risk assessment or end user check. So we check all parties to the transaction which you have stated in your application form. And lastly, we have authorization decision. So we either issue or deny a license. But once we deny a license, the industry stakeholders in the Philippines still has recourse. So they may still file first a motion for reconsideration with our office. If that's still denied, they may file an appeal with the NSC-STMCOM. So what are our plans for implementation? We will be coming up with our own website, and this will be some of the proposed website content. So the most important are commodity classification guidelines. What we want to come up with is also a commodity classification tool to assist industry stakeholders in identifying whether their items are covered under our list or not. Also, we'll be posting there our registration guidelines. Important also is our authorization guidelines, and as well as our ICP setup guidelines. For enforcement, we'll be posting penalty guidelines and also posting information on how to know your customer properly. We'll be posting their denials list, watch list, as well as persons, entities that are covered under the UN Security Council Resolution sanctions list. Okay, so this is the proposed enterprise outreach plan in the Philippines. We have identified that majority of our exports in the Philippines come from our economic zone locators. So what we intend to do is to come up with an enterprise outreach first with our PEZA, or Philippine Economic Zone locators. So we have already finished one in Cavite, and next week we'll be conducting one in Baguio. So three more are slated next year in Mactan, in Batangas, and in Laguna. We also intend to come up with a technical advisory committee. This will serve as a feedback forum for the industry, where the STMO would seek advice on emerging technologies and the compatibility of STMO policies with industry's business processes. So this committee will be comprised of members from key companies, industry associations, and academe. So lastly, what are the administrative and criminal penalties under our law? So administrative penalties will be imposed by our office, the STMO, and these are the administrative penalties. First, warnings or orders for corrective action. Second, limitation, revocation, or annulment of any authorization and or registration. Fines cover, there are three categories to fine. A fine of 250,000 pesos. Two, a fine that is twice the value of the strategic good or related service. And a fine that is assessed by the STMO. And lastly, the administrative penalty that we can impose is the cancellation or suspension of the registration and authorization to operate of the juridical person with our Securities and Exchange Commission or with the Department of Trade and Industry. These are the criminal penalties under our law. For deliberate and willful intent to commit violations of the STMA, the penalty is imprisonment for a period of 6 years and 1 day to 12 years. For attempts to commit violations of the STMA and other acts, the penalty is imprisonment for a period of 6 months and 1 day to 6 years. What we want to emphasize here is that once the STMO imposes an administrative penalty, it does not prevent us from filing a criminal case against an earring industry stakeholder. So that ends my presentation. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Janice. Again, you will see her again right after our first break on the industry panel that will be facilitated by Madam Fazia from Singapore Customs. Next, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Ms. Eliza Mastura Ahmed Hanipia, hopefully close enough. She is the Deputy Strategic Trade Controller of the Strategic Trade Secretariat, Ministry of International Trade and Industry of Malaysia. Again, another great opportunity to hear from one of our neighbors in strategic trade, and she will also be on the panel at the after break.
Selamat pagi and a very good morning. Firstly, I do not need to introduce myself because Mr. Scott has already clearly done that. I would like to thank the Singapore Customs for the invitation, as well as the MITI Japan and the Singapore Embassy, as well as Malaysian Embassy, Exbus particularly, for enable to Malaysia to attend this seminar this morning. So I would like to share the updates to Malaysian strategic controls since its inception in 2011. The Act was gazetted in 2010, but implemented in 2011, first January 2011. Has been 7 years and has been a good experience for Malaysia to being able to meet the international obligation as well as to ensure it is being embedded in our domestic laws to basically address the need to make sure that our industries are trading in a secure environment. So even after 7 years of implementation, we are still learning. We are still looking at many areas, many challenges, and we hope that we are able to improve our domestic implementation to ensure for an effective implementation with regards to export control. So today, this morning, I'll be presenting, touching a bit on the overview, and then the regulations and orders that is applicable in the strategic the export control in Malaysia, and then our current and future efforts. And hopefully, with these updates, the audience are able to look into areas that Malaysia or maybe we can improve, as well as if you have further engagement, questions, I am available for the rest of the day for better communication. It's going very fast. Okay. So as I mentioned earlier, it all started in Malaysia because of the international obligation at the international level. We are a member state of the United Nations, and we all know that the driver to this is the United Nations Security Council Resolution 1540. And because of this resolution, Malaysia and of course other member states of the United Nations must come up with a domestic regulation. And this is what we have done. In 2010, we have enacted the Strategic Trade Act. And as I mentioned earlier, the implementation was in 2011. And the ministry, the custody was given to the Ministry of International Trade and Industry. And the primary focus in Malaysia at that time was that trade facilitation. From then and even until now, it has always been trade facilitation, and hence why the export control is being put under the Ministry of International Trade and Industry. So as you can see, there's difference. In terms of operations, it is also at the Ministry of International Trade and Industry, as compared to the one in Singapore. It is vested on the customs authority in Singapore. But later on, I will share on our implementation, the inter-agency coordination, as to how we at MITI is able to implement export control effectively by way of inter-agency coordination. And today, the ministry will be addressing issues with related to trade facilitation as well as export control under the same domain. And at STS, we have adopted and embraced the tagline, facilitating trade in a secure trading environment. As you can see down here. And we hope to uphold this, and hopefully industries are also able to embrace this tagline to understand the importance of operating and doing trade in a secure trading environment. As mentioned earlier today, circumvention happens in almost every day, and the authority can do as much, but with industries eyes and ears and strong relationship with the authority, we certainly hope that better implementation can be done in terms of export control. The Secretariat operates alongside with tremendously with inter-agency coordination and cooperation. As such, today, even at the ministry, the STS remains to be such a small unit. And we remain to be the focal point for STA 2010, doing multitude of functions from permit issuance, policy formulations, advisory services, outreach, evaluation, as well as responsible for the operation of the e-permit STA, and also enforcement. And since its establishment in 2011, the STS has worked with within this framework. We have Strategic Trade Secretariat here, and we also have our partner licensing agencies, which have been in existence even before the Strategic Trade Act was implemented. So, Pharmaceutical Services Division, they are responsible for the poison, and they are the basically department responsible to enforce Poisons Act. And then we have Malaysian Communications and Multimedia Commission, they are in charge of telecommunication and electronics. And we also have Atomic Energy Licensing Board, in charge of nuclear-related items, materials. So essentially, they are responsible for these subject matters or areas. And whereas Strategic Trade Secretariat issues permit for dual-use items, materials, aerospace, marine, and also we also issue permits on behalf of responsible agencies, such as the National Chemical Weapons Convention for Malaysia and other chemicals, biological agents, pesticides, pathogens included. These are all in our strategic list. I'm sure most of the industries are familiar with our strategic list. We adopted the European Union list, both of military and also dual use list. And recently we have gazetted our new list, and most of the time our list is 1 year behind of the EU list because the need for us to gazette, and of course we need to translate into the Bahasa Malaysia text, as Bahasa Malaysia text would be the official text. But there's no problem in using the English text. And normally industries are far ahead of us. They would be using the EU list, but for the purpose of permit issuance, permit and licensings, we have to use the Malaysian official list. Although, like now, we know that the European Union has published a new list for 2018, which I believe to be enforced in December 2018. But as soon as it's being published, the Malaysian, we at STS will be looking into the text, and we will adopt and do the translation and only gazette. So normally that would take a lag of 6 to 8 months, just like how it's being done this year. So over time, we try to expedite, but again, there's always a constraint due to the technicalities. Okay, and we also have our enforcement agencies that has been a great assistance to us, because at STS, we do not have an enforcement arm, and we depend very largely on the Royal Malaysian Customs and the Royal Malaysian Police, as well as the Malaysian Maritime Enforcement Agencies as the Coastal Guards, Malaysian Communications and Multimedia Commissions, because they have purview under the control list. The AELB, Atomics Energy Licensing Board, the Pharmaceutical Services Department, and also we have included the Central Bank, the Securities Commission, and also Labuan Offshore Financial Services Authority, because our STA covers proliferation financing. It under the Section 6 of the Strategic Trade Act, it also addresses the proliferation financing financing subject, and we also have issued guideline on targeted financing sanctions. I will share you in a bit later on the current updates and also future efforts. Okay, next would be, what does our STA 2010 entails? It covers basically The export activity, transit, transshipment, brokering, and other activities. Other activities here would largely on the financial proliferation of weapons of mass destructions. And all the activities here are concerns with goods, listed and unlisted, including technology that facilitates the design, development, and production of weapon of mass destructions and its delivery systems. So technically, essentially, it covers a whole wide range of activities because we have also other activities in addition to all the four main activities that we often see in the export control system. Unlisted here would also mean that we address the catch-all provision. The catch-all provision would generally addresses goods that are not listed, where a person basically suspects that goods and technology are intended to use or likely to be used for WMD purpose, then it automatically falls under the unlisted and addresses the catch-all provision, as well as when it is being notified by the authority. Authority here would mean the Strategic Trade Secretariat. If the authority inform or notify that the goods or technology intended would likely be used for WMD purposes, then automatically the goods the goods requires permit or license to be issued before any activities listed under the STA can be conducted. Okay, under the STA 2010, we have regulation and orders that basically operates to enable agencies, authorities, and also the stakeholders to abide by. So we have under STA 2010 has been prescribed first schedule where we have all the forms, and then second schedule we have fees. For now in Malaysia, for processing, there's no fees involved, but because under the National Single Window, we have established the e-permit STA, there's a certain fees that has to be paid to the service provider, which is Dagangnet. So every exporter or every, including individuals who have to use or who have to apply for permit, they would be required to first access to the permit by way of subscribing to the system. So that's a requirement before the permit can be applied. Third schedule is the strategy items, transit transshipment permit requirement. Basically, the third schedule sets out the countries that are embargo and whether or not countries are prohibited or countries are restricted. And if it falls under the third schedule, then a permit is required. And the fourth schedule is about record keeping. Under the STA, you are required to keep your documents for a period of 6 years. And within that time, if you do not keep your documents, and when the authority requires for that and you are unable to provide it, it is an offence under the law, and action can be taken against the person or the company. And we have the Strategic Trade Regulations 2010. Basically, this is the operative provisions that authorities have to abide by in implementing Strategic Trade Act. We have also Strategic Trade Strategic Items Amendment Order 2018. This is the recent one. the strategic trade restricted end users and prohibited end users, order 2010. We have an amendment in 2016. I will share with you later with the updates. Strategic trade amendment of schedule order 2010. And also the Strategic Trade United Nations Security Council's Resolution 2010. We do not have a United Nations Act like Singapore, but it is mostly in our domestic legislation. It is embedded by way of regulation, the operative framework established under the parent act. For Strategic Trade Act, we have the Strategic Trade UNSCR 2010. And this was also recently amended in 2018. Okay, there are basically four permit categories under the that industries are accessible to. Of course, the single permit. This one is the easy access that all companies or all stakeholders can reach to where export control permit is required. It is a one-time permit, so use one time and that's it. Even though the quantity being approved is at a certain quantity, but if you underutilize it, then the permit is as good as has been used. So that is why it's been called the single permit, and it is valid for 6 months. And the record keeping is still 6 years. So doesn't make any changes to record keeping requirement. As to multiple and bulk permit, the difference would be for bulk, you can send multiple items, but to single country. And it is valid for 2 years. As well as for multiple, you can send multiple items from multiple countries, and the validity period is also 2 years. However, these two type of permits will require ICP, which is the internal compliance program embedded into the company. Then only you can apply to STS MITI for approval. Once approval, then these two permits are accessible for application. We have a special permit. Remember the Schedule 3 I referred earlier with regards to the restricted countries. We are not saying that we cannot export to restricted countries. You can export, but you're required to apply for a special permit. And these special permits, technically, effectively, it is a single permit, and the validity period is for a period of 1 year. So all in all, there are four permits that you have to know that you can have access to. And in Malaysia, the ICP, the institutionalization of ICP would require companies to ensure five elements are being met. The first one is the management commitment, screening process, training, record keeping, and also audit or evaluation. Okay, after 7 years of implementation, of course, there are hiccups and always areas of improvement. And as mentioned earlier, we have our strategic trade restricted end users and prohibited end users order 2010, and it has to be read together with the strategic trade UNSCR order 2010. And we see that there's always changes in the UNSCR sanctions measures. A lot of measures has been adopted quite aggressively within the last few years, and it has been a challenge for us to cope, because we have to do the translation, and then as well as gazette, just like our strategic list need to be done. So in 2016, the strategic trade restricted end users and prohibited end users order 2016 was gazetted and implemented on the 21st June 2016. And Effectively, it allows for auto-adoption pursuant to the UNSCR resolutions. But this amendment or this order only affects the UNSCR 1718 against the DPRK and UNSCR 2231 against Iran. So only these two. So basically, whenever there's new list or new resolution being published in the UNSCR in the UN website, it also allows Malaysia to do auto adoption. So if you see there's a new industries need to be sensitive on this, you do not need to look at our list for DPRK and Iran. You do not need to look at the Gazette list, but you can look up into the UN's list because it is auto adoption effective 21st June 2016. So this is the quickest way that our Attorney General Chambers has accommodated us to ensure that we meet the UNSCR implementation. And then we have our Act Amendment in 2017, the first amendment since its inception. Essentially, the amendment were made on provisions relating to broker definition. Now it has the word from one country to another country. Before, it did not have that word. So it basically, the definition sort of covers everybody, everyone who is involved in the negotiating, facilitating, sales and purchase. But with the amendment, it only covers persons, negotiates, facilitates, sales and purchase from one country to another country. So that's effectively the amendment on broker definition. And the brokering of strategic items since the amendment, which is from the 8th September 2017, shall not apply to person whose sole involvement in ancillary services. So we have excluded ancillary services, namely transport, financial services, insurance and reinsurance, and also general advertisement. So that is not included in our STA any longer under the brokering of strategic items. We have also amended our provision on the penalty. We have established the administrative penalty. However, it has yet to be implemented because we are still at the stage of tying the loose ends to ensure when it is being conducted, there's a uniformity and also to address any inconsistency. Because as I mentioned earlier, we have when it comes to enforcement, we have many agencies that we depend on. We have customs, we have Royal Malaysian Police, we have the Maritime, we have also the licensing agencies. So we need to have a strong standard operating procedures and also guidelines as well as regulation to ensure that the administrative penalty is being done in a proper manner. And in terms of the criminal punishment or criminal penalty, we have amended from minimum to maximum. The word used before was not exceed not less than, but the effectively the amendment has already sort of how do I say? We are being more lenient in that sense. It is no longer maximum but minimum. So all punishment has a minimum amount. It must not exceed a certain amount. For example, for arms and related materials, the minimum amount would be 10 million. Whereas before, it can be the minimum amount is 10 million, but now the maximum amount is 10 million. So in a way, we are more lenient. Why? I know Japan has increased their criminal penalty charges, but for Malaysia, because of our constant engagement with the industry, industry says that it is hefty, and if that happens, it may jeopardize the industry. So if there's conviction, it may affect our industries. So because of this engagement and through good regulatory practice, we have listened to their concern and we have incorporated that in our STA amendment. In terms of end user statement, under the regulation, we have our form, and the form 5 is our end user statement that is mandatory. But with the amendment in 2017, EUS is no longer mandatory in the format of form 5. However, we still encourage industries to use form 5 because it is the most easiest and simplest way to meet the authorities' requirements. But for special permit purpose, special permit application, the flexibility on EUS is not applicable. For special permit, for the 13 restricted countries, EUS Form 5 is still mandatory because of the nature, we just have to enforce the EUS mandatory requirement. But for other cases, this is subject to case-by-case cases. In order to facilitate trade, we have been flexible enough to accept other documents, for example, the PO, the BL, the bill of lading, the airway bill, packing list, agreement, or even advance manifest for us to be able to process your permit application. We also have one provision, new provision in the amendment, which is the presumption of export. This was incorporated because of the we receive proposals from our enforcement agencies because with this provision, it reinforced the law enforcement to execute better exercise. So with the presumption of export provision, our law enforcement officers can conduct their enforcement activities, more effectively or more confidently without any gray area that they had to address prior to enforcement activities being conducted. We have our strategic trade, strategic items amendment order 2018, which I have already mentioned earlier. The new list is already published in our website and accessible. Industries are encouraged to do search using this new list. And then we have a circular of directive of implementation of targeted financial sanctions relating to proliferation financing. This is, I think it was published in quite recently, 13th of April 2018, and basically it sets out clearer obligation for the reporting institutions to submit to the central bank whenever there's cases on targeted financial sanctions. We have ITT guideline, intangible transfer technology. It is interesting to note Philippines ICP program, which has already incorporated the technology elements in the key elements of ICP. For Malaysia, we have ITT guideline, which also currently we are looking into embedding this provision into our ICP. So hopefully we are able to also improve our ICP requirements, incorporating intangible technology transfer requirement. We have strategic trade items finder mobile apps. You can always download the STI 2010 available both on Android and also Apple, and you can do a quick search. So this is some form of trade facilitation that we are doing for industries to have better access to identify whether the items are strategic or not, requires permit or otherwise. We have internal compliance program ICP and fund enhancement. Why it is in still wide font is because that is our future efforts. We hope to improve our ICP, we have also look into yes trade of Singapore's custom, and it is very comprehensive, I must say, and it is an area that Malaysia can also look into and improve our ICP requirement. In terms of trade facilitation, because we are MITI, so we cannot ignore our role to continue facilitate trade, particularly to our industries. We have our website, our portal, that has extensive amount of information. It's just a matter of our stakeholders to reach out. We have our strategy items list. And then we have online permit application, so companies no longer have to come to MITI to apply. It can be done remotely. You don't even have to go to our regional office because it is accessible at your end. We have ICP, and today 25% of STA companies are registered and has an approved ICP status. Under the regulation, we also have exemption, which is Regulation 22 and Regulation 25. Regulation 22 is for government authorities, whether it is our foreign government or our national government, who is carrying out duties on behalf of government, exemption is applicable and accessible. And under Regulation 25, we have also exemption to transit and transshipment, mainly for dual use items. And of course, there's conditions that need to be met. It must arrive into the free commercial zone and remain in free commercial zone at all times for a period of not exceeding 30 days. So this is accessible to our industry. However, it is not applicable to restricted end users and prohibited end users. And under Schedule 3 of the STA regulations, it is also not applicable to military items. It is not applicable to nuclear reactors, gas centrifuge plant, not applicable to uranium, maraging steels, and also tungsten. Not applicable to toxic chemicals and also human pathogens. So there's always a carve out list, and industries must know this, must be aware where permit is required. Because without permit and you are doing these activities, you are in violation of the Act and you are subject to a very huge penalty. Okay, this is our related information link that is accessible to everybody. Our email help desk basically is at admin.sts@miti.gov.my. We have a KPI of response KPI of 3 days, 3 working days. So normally it will take within 1 to 3 days for any question, any queries that are being posed to us for a feedback. And we have STS awareness video. This is available on YouTube. And it is a very easy to understand, probably easier than my presentation today. So I encourage you to access this link and watch this video. And we also have additional information related to our licensing partner agencies subjects. We have MCMC's address, web address, as well as AELB web address for more information. And in our website, in our portal, if you have any questions related to chemicals, related to atomic energy, as well as multimedia and communication items, there's the list of contact persons that you can reach to. So there's always a shortcut. You do not want to come to STS because, oh, STS doesn't really know about this. Never mind. Go direct to our licensing partner agencies. They are there to help you. They have better access. But again, as I mentioned, STS is the focal point. Please come to STS whenever you have trouble accessing to our licensing partner agencies. Okay. MITI, Strategic Trade Secretariat, we are very serious on implementing strategic trade management. Of course, at the same time, we understand and we pledge to our stakeholders that we want to facilitate trade in a secure trading environment. And with STA, since its inception, we can see that Malaysia's companies are better protected. We provide assurance that trading is safe because companies are required to comply with the STA 2010. What we are worried is companies who are not complying, basically looking ways to circumvent our STA 2010. So that is mainly our concern. But again, we know that we need to work out. We need to work closely with our industries because they know better. Sometimes information are being escalated to us from the industries, and we have to thank you for that, for being ear and eye for the authority. And trade promotion and strategic trade management are two sides of the same coin. Balancing national interests, trade security, we want to increase international trade, we want to enhance our image at the same time to be seen as a responsible trading nation, but at the same time, we want to maintain a good cordial bilateral and multilateral ties with our neighbors and also our other foreign countries. So I would like to reiterate that industries play a significant role and important to work together. And then we need to ensure that our export control system and management are implemented effectively. Thank you.
Ms. Eliza, thank you so much. That was an amazing presentation. Okay, as we come to our first break, I want to point out a couple of things. I like to get a little interactive. So my first question of the day is, how many people were here last year? Raise your hands. Okay, come on, I know there's a few people that were here last year. I recognize faces. How many people were here last year at this event? Okay, so we're probably looking at about less than half. Take this time to meet someone you don't know. Take this time at break to go introduce yourself, exchange business cards, have a conversation. There's a lot of information you're going to get today, but some of these business card transactions during breaks are the most important ones. Secondly, those of you that come to these events know that we generally pass out towards the end of the day a feedback form, but we're doing a little bit differently this year. Customs is setting up through a QR code that you'll be able to scan and do it online. That actually makes it a lot easier for us from having to input this stuff. But please take the time to do that, because you'll notice that this year, the tables are set different and the presentations are going to be different, because we're going to go into a panel next and then a panel after lunch. That's for you. That's based off of your feedback. So please make sure that when you're filling out your forms to give us that feedback. And lastly, before we go to break, take the time to talk to Singapore Customs about trade first. There's a lot of customs officers here. Grab one, ask them, what is this thing called Trade First? It's a really, really cool program that, as a member of the Bureau of Industry and Security, I would love to go to my boss and say, let's set this up. But unfortunately, way too big of an area to cover and not very many of us to do it. So take the time to get with Singapore Customs and talk to them about Trade First. It's an amazing program. Okay, so it is now a little after 10:25. We're going to try and start at 10:40. So there's coffee and tea out there, and the restrooms are to your left. Thank you so much. Nice.